Hello everyone, I am Tanvi Kaur and I welcome you to this series called RBI 247. So we are back with this series of RBI 247 for our upcoming RBI 2022 batch. So in this very series, we pick up some important financial topics, the RBI notifications, its master directions and other finance currents, and we try to discuss them with the help of questions. So we'll try and pick up some very important financial topics which are quite relevant for your RBI exams, and we'll try to understand the core concepts. So before beginning up with the session, for all those who are watching this video for the very first time, you can subscribe to our channel and press this bell icon for all latest updates and notifications. You can also join our Telegram group where we share some free quizzes, the updates for all our latest videos, and you can also post your queries over here. So let's not waste any time and just move on to question number one. So this is the very first question, which says, RBI came up with master directions related to the amalgamation of urban cooperative banks 2021. Which of the following statements are correctly related to these directions? So RBI recently came up with some directions related to amalgamation. Amalgamation of whom? Amalgamation of the urban cooperative banks. So we'll first discuss these master directions and then we'll get back to the question, read the statements and try to answer this question. So let's look at the very first thing. So under these master directions, which came up in the month of March 2021, RBI came up with certain directions which are applicable to the cooperative banks. And which cooperative banks? To the urban cooperative banks. So if urban cooperative banks want to amalgamate, want to merge together, then these directions will be applicable to them. So let's first discuss some important terms which will help you understand these directions. So we need to understand what is amalgamation, what are cooperative banks, what is an amalgamated and an amalgamating company. So if I talk about a cooperative bank, we have heard about the commercial banks. We have private sector banks, we have public banks, we have some foreign banks, some regional rural banks, and similarly we have the urban cooperative banks as well. You would have heard the term cooperative societies. So what are they? They are basically a kind of firm where the members come up together voluntarily and they conduct some kind of business whose profits they reap all together. So there is a democratic kind of a concept where every person has the right to vote, one person, one vote, and whatever profits they reap, they are shared by the members. So such firms operate for their members. Similarly, we have the cooperative banks. So what happens in case of a cooperative bank? Suppose there are certain customers like you and me, if we come up together and we form a bank where we are not only the customers who are taking the loans from such bank, but we are also the owners of that bank. So such a bank is a cooperative bank. Thus, in case of a cooperative bank, the people who are the customers of that bank, they are the owners as well. So, jo log us bank se loans lenge, us pe deposit denge, wahi us bank ke owners bhi hote hain. Such a kind of bank operates for its owners, for its members, to provide the benefits to the members. So, it's a financial entity that belongs to the members. And these banks are not only cooperated, not only under the guidelines of RBI Act or the Banking Regulation Act, but they also have to be governed by the Cooperative Societies Act. So they are registered under the state cooperative societies, and they are regulated by whom? They are regulated by RBI. They are governed by the Banking Regulations Act and as well as the banking laws which relate to your cooperative societies. So these two things regulate such banks. If we talk about the cooperative banks, we have different cooperative banks, especially in the rural areas. And they focus on what? They focus on protecting the members from the usurious money lenders. You all know that in the rural areas, there's a major problem where people are not able to get the funding. They conduct agricultural activities, they want funding, they want credit, but easy credit is not available. Moreover, instead of relying on banks, they rely on the usurious money lenders who charge a lot of interest from them. So, un money lenders say, उन members को protect करने के लिए this concept came up that members can come up together, form banks from where they can take the lending. So it helps to provide cheaper credit. If you put some deposit in a cooperative bank, you will earn more interest vis-a-vis a commercial bank. Moreover, you will easily be granted loan for different agriculture purposes, for buying improved seeds, fertilizers, more modern implements. So cooperative credit is easily available by these banks. Moreover, in urban areas also we have such banks where they help the small and other medium-sized businesses to explore, to basically expand by providing the necessary funding. So this is the concept of cooperative banks. Now RBI has come up with these directions where it allows the urban cooperative banks to amalgamate together. So let us understand the meaning of amalgamation. If I talk about amalgamation, you would have heard that this bank gets taken over that by that bank. Do bank milke ek naya bank bana rahe hain, ya do bank merge kar rahe together and one bank is getting absorbed by the other bank. So that is amalgamation. Where we have, suppose we have bank XYZ which is not functioning very well. Okay, so there is a bigger bank, say HDFC, which is willing to take over this bank. So these banks come up together and they basically merge into a bigger entity of HDFC. So XYZ को HDFC ने टेक ओवर कर लिया and HDFC becomes a more larger entity. This is amalgamation. Two companies, two businesses, two banks coming together to form a larger entity, larger bank is known as amalgamation. So here what is amalgamation? They have, RBI has defined amalgamation as one or more urban cooperative banks amalgamating with another urban cooperative bank. So if say XYZ is a bank operating in one state, okay, it merges with another urban cooperative bank to form a larger cooperative bank, then that is an example of amalgamation. Now you can see at least two banks should be here to amalgamate. Ek bank jab dusra bank usko take over karega, tabhi amalgamation hoga. If two banks are not there, at least two banks are not there, amalgamation is not possible. So there will be one bank which is willing to give itself up and there's another bank which is willing to take up that bank. Now the question comes, why a bank would like to be amalgamated with another bank? Suppose we have this XYZ bank and it is not functioning very well. Now it feels that in future it is not going to function anymore and this business, its business may be shut down. So it's better that if it gets amalgamated with some other bank. XYZ bank agar achche se operate nahi kar raha hai, HDFC has the funding, has the expertise, and if it takes over this bank will be able to function even better. Now, why would HDFC like to amalgamate itself with XYZ? The reason can be that HDFC will become even a larger entity. It will have more customers. XYZ ke customers bhi HDFC ke paas aa jayenge. It will expand its area of operations, more branches, more business. Okay, so because of these different banks come up together. Now, here is a bank which is willing to get taken over and here's another bank which will take it over. So that is the concept of amalgamated and amalgamating bank. Amalgamated bank is the bank which will be taken over. Why amalgamated? Because in future it will get merged into a larger entity. So that is amalgamated bank. In this case, this XYZ is the bank which is the amalgamated bank. Then talking about amalgamating bank, the bank which is going to take over some other bank, to acquire some other bank, is the amalgamating bank. So in this case, your HDFC bank is the bank which will take over XYZ and is thus the amalgamating bank. So this is the concept of amalgamated, amalgamating bank. So okay, I hope the concept is clear. Jo bank takeover ho jayega, wo XYZ hai, wo amalgamated bank hai, aur jo bank उसको अब्सॉर्ब कर लेगा, मर्ज उसके साथ हो जाएगा, उसको टेक ओवर कर लेगा, दैट इज द अमैल्गमेटिंग बैंक, व्हिच इन दिस केस इज द एचडीएफसी बैंक. मूविंग अहेड विद दीज डायरेक्शंस, आरबीआई हैज गिवन थ्री सर्कमस्टेंसेस अंडर व्हिच दीज यूसीबीज कैन बी मर्ज टुगेदर. सो थ्री केसेस आर देयर. इन तीन कंडीशंस में से किसी भी एक कंडीशन के कंसिडर आप करो, अगर किसी भी सर्कमस्टांस को इफ यू कंसिडर इन एनी ऑफ दीज थ्री सर्कमस्टांसेस, दिस प्रपोजल ऑफ अमेलगमेशन कैन बी अप्रूव्ड बाय आरबीआई. सो वॉट आर दोज थ्री सर्कमस्टांसेस? द फर्स्ट वन सेज वेन द नेट वर्थ, वॉट वेन द नेट वर्थ ऑफ द अमेलगमेटेड बैंक इज positive, and the amalgamating bank assures to protect entire deposits of all depositors of the amalgamated bank. So what they are saying ki the amalgamated bank, jo amalgamated bank hai, like we had XYZ in our case, agar uski net worth positive hai, okay, and your amalgamating bank, that is HDFC, is willing to protect the deposits of all your XYZ depositors, jinhone bhi XYZ mein paisa deposit kiya hai, agar HDFC is saying ki hum un sab depositors ko protect karenge, then in that case, this amalgamation proposal can be given to RBI. This is the first circumstance. The second one says that the net worth of amalgamated bank is negative, but the amalgamating bank still assures to protect the deposits. So, is case mein iski net worth positive thi. Okay, but what if its net worth is negative? Even if its net worth is negative, agar amalgamating bank jo hai, if HDFC in this case is willing to still protect the depositors of XYZ bank, then in that case also the amalgamation is possible. So this was the second case. Now talking about the third case, it says when the net worth is negative and amalgamating bank assures to protect depositors with financial support of state government. So HDFC is saying that okay, we'll protect your investors although your net worth is negative, but we have one condition, and that condition is that if we need financial support, then state government will provide us the financial support. So agar state government aapko financial support degi, then you are willing to protect the depositors. Even if the amalgamated bank's net worth is negative, then also amalgamation is possible. So these are the three situations when amalgamation is possible. You must be aware of these three cases. Now if you are there in any one of these circumstances, okay, you as a bank, as an urban cooperative bank, can merge with another urban cooperative bank, and it should be a voluntary act which RBI will approve. Voluntarily jab ye banks agree karenge to amalgamate, then RBI can approve your amalgamation. If we move ahead further, there is a need of approval of both board of directors as well as shareholders. So both of them play a really very important role. So boards play a very important role. If you want to amalgamate with other cooperative bank, then you need 2/3 majority of board's approval. So 2/3 board jo hai, both amalgamated or amalgamating bank ka combined, uski 2/3 majority is needed to get the approval of RBI. Further, once you get the 2/3 approval of your board of directors, you also need a 2/3 approval of the shareholders. So, ye dono approvals jab mil jayenge, both of the shareholders and the board of directors, then this proposal can further be taken to the RBI, okay, to the registered office of RBI, and RBI will, after all the necessary requirements are fulfilled, will sanction this approval. So, this is whole process of amalgamation. You need to be there under one of the three circumstances, then only after the board's and shareholders' approval, your proposal of amalgamation will be approved by RBI. I hope these directions are clear. Now let's move back to our question. The first statement says amalgamating bank means UCB which proposes to transfer its business. No, it is an amalgamated bank. One which will take over is the amalgamating bank. So this statement is wrong. The second one says the proposal of amalgamation can be made to RBI only in one case when net worth is positive. This is again incorrect because there are three cases where amalgamation is possible. The third statement says that the decision of amalgamation needs to be approved by 2/3 majority of board members. So this statement is absolutely correct. We just discussed this. So only statement 3 is correct. Thus answer is option B. Now let's move on to question number 2. So this question says, which of the following is a new type of social network that lets you speculate on people and posts with real money, and it's built from the ground up as its own custom blockchain? So here we are having three important keywords. One is that it is using your social network. Second one is that you speculate. Speculate on whom? Speculate on the people, their posts. And third is that it uses the blockchain concept. So if you see these three things, this concept is somewhat trending these days. It is a new platform which has come up, and the answer is BitCloud. So let us understand this concept of BitCloud. The answer is option C. So what is BitCloud? BitCloud can also be called as the, just a second. Yeah, so BitCloud can also be called the social media stock exchange. You will get an idea why we can call it a social media stock exchange. What is Bit and what is Cloud? Let us first understand this. This word has been derived from two words, Bit and Cloud. Bit means Bitcoin over here, and clout means how famous you are on a social media platform. Aap kitne famous ho kisi social media platform mein, like Instagram, Facebook, Twitter and others. So this is BitCloud. We can call it a stock exchange of social media. What we do in a stock exchange? We have shares listed of different companies. We can buy Reliance share, we can buy Tata shares. So we trade in shares on a stock exchange. But what is BitCloud? BitCloud is also like an exchange, but here we don't trade the shares of the companies. Rather, we trade on the coins of people. Okay, now think that if you have a coin in the name of Virat Kohli or in the name of, say, Mr. Amitabh Bachchan, they are big personalities which people are aware of, whom people follow on social media platforms. So if we had a share listed on a stock exchange in their name, obviously we like to invest in them because we know them, they are great personalities and they are quite famous. So, but stock exchanges don't allow this. Here only companies' share are traded. So this is, BitCloud is a platform where these people are traded. Har ek person ke naam pe ek coin hai. Each person has a coin in its name and we can buy and sell that coin. Okay, it is worth some dollars. So let us go deeper into this concept. It is an architecture similar to Bitcoin. We know Bitcoin is a cryptocurrency, a digital currency. So here we not only trade using a digital currency, but we also make use of the social network, the post profiles, the how many followers you have. Okay, so it lets the users to speculate on the personalities. Like if you want, you can buy a coin of our Prime Minister Mr. Narendra Modi, you can buy the coin of Elon Musk, you can buy the coin of Rihanna. And the more the popular the people are on social media platforms, the more their coins will be bought and the more high price those coins will have. Now this platform has got more trending these days. People are investing here because it is backed by the support of different venture capitalists. So we have Sequoia Capital, Anderson, Social Capital, all of them have invested in this platform and thus people are also investing. So if you want to work as a stock market where instead of companies, people invest in the reputation of individuals, then you can go for this BitCloud platform. You will understand it a bit more when I explain you how this concept works. So you need two kinds of assets over here. First of all, you need BitCloud, which is the currency using which you can trade on this platform. How you can buy BitCloud? For that, you need Bitcoin. If you have a Bitcoin, using that you can purchase a BitCloud. Bitcoin deke aap BitCloud ka coin khareed sakte ho. And that BitCloud will be used to buy the creator coins. Har person ke naam pe ek coin hoga, that is a creator coin. For example, if Mr. Narendra Modi is listed over here, then we'll have a coin in the name of Mr. Narendra Modi. That is the creator coin. So people like you and me can also have their coins on this platform. Now, if we don't have that many followers on different social media platforms, people are not aware about us, they would not like to invest in our stocks. In our coins. Okay, here we don't have stocks, we have coins on which we trade. If instead of us, some big celebrity comes up with his coin, then obviously people would like to invest in his coin. So this is how it works. So the more the coins will be bought, the more will be its price. Similarly, like अगर आप कोई स्टॉक खरीदते हो स्टॉक एक्सचेंज में, जितना ज्यादा वो स्टॉक खरीदा जाता है उसकी डिमांड बढ़ती है, द प्राइस इज राइज. सो सिमिलरली इफ यू बाय मोर कॉइन्स ओवर हियर द प्राइस विल राइज एंड इफ यू सेल देम इट्स प्राइस विल फॉल. सो दिस इज द क्रिएटर कॉइन. क्रिएटर कॉइन, एवरी पर्सन कैन क्रिएट हिज ओन कॉइन. आई कैन कम अप ऑन दिस प्लेटफॉर्म, जस्ट रजिस्टर ओवर हियर एंड माई कॉइन विल बी क्रिएटेड विच कैन बी ट्रेडेड. नाउ यू कैन सी हियर आर सम बिग पर्सनैलिटीज लाइक एलन मस्क, जस्टिन बीबर, बराक ओबामा, रिहाना. सो ऑल दीज पीपल हैव नॉट देमसेल्व्स रजिस्टर्ड ऑन दिस प्लेटफॉर्म. ओके, डोंट थिंक दैट इट इज कंप्लीटली रिलायबल कि इतने बड़े लोग यहां रजिस्टर कर रहे हैं, सो वाई नॉट वी ऑल्सो इन्वेस्ट. नो, वॉट दिस प्लेटफॉर्म डिड इज इट went through the Twitter profiles and from there 15,000 influencers जिनकी profile काफी अच्छी थी, काफी trending थी on your Twitter, उनके accounts को यहाँ पे preload कर दिया गया. So these persons have not created their accounts on their own. These accounts have been created by BitCloud themselves. So the profiles of 15,000 influencers have been picked from Twitter and preloaded on this platform. Now you will come on this platform and see, okay, we have Elon Musk's coin trading as $104. So this person is, you know them, okay, this person is a great personality, you will like to invest in them. The more people like you invest, its price will rise even further. But they have not created coins themselves. Although they have not created, they can claim the coins. Agar Elon Musk future mein aake dekhta hai ki uski yahan profile created hai, if he sees that his profile is created, he can click on it, he can claim using a connection between his account on Twitter and over here, and then he can claim the coins. But as of now, he has not yet claimed. So, jinke aage ye clock bani hai. The clock here indicates that the person has not himself created a coin. This has been preloaded by BitCloud. Okay, there are other persons like Applusk. Here there is no clock, means this person has registered himself. Okay, so this is how you can do trading on this platform. You can buy and sell the coins of Justin Bieber, of Rihanna, or any other person. Okay, now the question comes up about its legality in India. You must be aware that there is cryptocurrency bill already pending with RBI. Okay, so we are thinking of banning currencies like Bitcoin, then how can we rely on such platforms? जब हम बिटकॉइन जैसी करेंसीज को ही बैन करने का सोच रहे हैं, वी आर थिंकिंग ऑफ कमिंग अप विद आर ओन डिजिटल करेंसी, देन द एक्सेप्टेंस ऑफ दिस काइंड ऑफ अ प्लेटफॉर्म इन कंट्री लाइक इंडिया सीम्स वेरी डाइसी. मोर ओवर पीपल आर सेइंग दैट इट इज अ स्कैम, इट इज क्वाइट मिसलीडिंग बिकॉज विदाउट देयर परमिशन देयर अकाउंट्स हैव ऑलरेडी बीन क्रिएटेड. बट इट वॉज अ न्यू कॉन्सेप्ट विच हैज कम अप दीज डेज, सो आई वॉन्टेड टू एक्सप्लेन दिस टू यू ऑल. So this is how popular you are on social media platform can be beneficial for you if you want to get yourself traded on this platform. This is the concept of BitCloud. Now let's move on to our next question. This is question number 3. It says, the government of India has recently been quite active in divesting its stake in different public sector enterprises. After its disinvestment or divestment proposals in 2021 budget, government currently in April 2021 is planning to further divest its 10 to 20% stake in two mini Ratna public sector enterprises. So you must be knowing ki India ne recently disinvestment ke decisions liye after the budget. Okay, we were planning to disinvest. Now another proposal has come jahan pe two public sector enterprises hain jahan government is thinking to disinvest. It is thinking that it will disinvest 10% stake in one firm and 20% in the other. So you have to identify what's the answer. So the answer to this question is option B, the National Fertilizers Limited, NFL, and the RCFL, that is Rashtriya Chemicals Fertilizers Limited. These are the two mini Ratna public sector enterprises in which government is thinking to disinvest. So it will go for a 20% disinvestment in National Fertilizers Company and 10% in the RCFL. So this is the proposal. Other than this, government is also planning to go for asset monetization. Okay, so the department called DIPAM, it has invited bids from the international property consultants. Government ke paas kuch flats and departments hain of two major firms called Hindustan Cables and of BEML, and government is thinking that these flats and apartments have not been utilized, so why not give it to some private sector people who will trade or who will basically bid for that, and they will use them, and in return we'll not only be able to utilize these assets but also gain some amount. So it will be more clear when I explain you the concept of asset monetization. So what is asset monetization? Monetizing the assets. Assets se kuch economic value generate karna. Generating some money out of your assets is your asset monetization. Now, government had numerous assets, like it has railways, roadways, and many such assets have not properly being utilized. Government ke paas ye faltu mein pade hue hain aur government unse paise generate nahi kar pa rahi hai. So if government give it on a lease, on a rent to some private sector firm, then it will not only earn some amount from it, but also its unutilized assets will get utilized. So this is an alternative to disinvest, where you are not giving the stake on the company, but you are giving it as a lease, okay, and those assets are getting utilized and you are earning something. So process of converting assets to economic value is asset monetization. The assets which lie idle can be monetized with the private entities bidding for them. So as you can see over here, the financial bids from international consultant is being invited. International property consultants ko invite kiya ja raha hai taki flats and apartments jo in public sector enterprises ke unutilized hai, these unutilized apartments and flats can be given on a lease basis to these international property consultants, and in return some monetizing can happen. Now this is the concept of asset monetization. I talked about DIPAM. So what is this DIPAM? DIPAM stands for the Department of Investment and Public Asset Management. So it is the agency which deals with all of this restructuring of your public sector enterprises, of their making them more efficient, dealing with their disinvestment. So it's the agency of your Union Finance Ministry dealing in the restructuring of your PSUs. It was set up when? It was set up in the year 1999. It was as a Department of Disinvestment. Pehle iska naam tha Department of Disinvestment. Then it was renamed as Ministry of Disinvestment. After that, finally in 2016, it was again renamed as Department of Investment and Public Asset Management. So it is managing the public assets and it's also dealing in the disinvestment. So this is the vision, this is the role of your DIPAM. Now, I came up with this question where it was quite a factual question where I just asked about the name of the companies. You can also be asked some conceptual questions on disinvestment. Like, if you talk about the objectives of disinvestment, koi bhi public sector firm disinvestment kyun karna chahegi? What's the objective behind disinvesting? Like, one of the reason can be your assets are not properly utilized, so you want to better utilize them. Okay, unnecessary they are adding to your financial burden. Okay, you want to generate more returns from such assets. You want to raise money, so you disinvest and you raise money which you can use in different projects to fund your growth and development programs. So I took a session on disinvestment for your last year's batch also, where I covered these in detail. So there I framed one question which I would like to discuss with you all. So this is the question which was already covered in previous session, where we asked about which of the following is the objective of disinvestment. Okay, so such kind of conceptual questions can also be asked. They can frame a case study where they'll give you the case like I gave you, that this company is the government is giving up 10% stake, 10-20% stake. So identify the concept and which of the following is a correct objective. So aise objectives wo disinvestment ke state kar sakte hain. So such kind of questions should also be clear with you. So the answer here is that all the three above stated are the objectives other than this. Agar aapko 100% control chahiye, then obviously you will not disinvest. So this can't be an objective. Remaining objectives I have just discussed with you. So these kind of questions can also come up. Okay, I have not mentioned this question. I have not basically put same question because it was covered in previous sessions. But for your reference, I have added it over here. Now let's move on to the last question of the day. It says, that is question number 4. It says, Hindustan Copper, a central public sector enterprise under the Ministry of Mines, is the only operating copper ore producing mining company in India and also the only vertically integrated producer of the copper in the country. Now, this was just an information about the company. I think it will not have any use in the question. Okay. So it's a case-based question which further says that the company raised 500 crores through a financing method wherein there was a wide participation of investors like mutual funds, insurance companies, banks, foreign institutional investors. Identify the method used by Hindustan Copper to raise this amount. So recently this public sector enterprise has raised 500 crores. You have to identify which of the following methods it has used to raise the funding. Is it mutual fund? Is it IPO? Is it FPO? Is it QIP? Or is it a rights issue? So yahan pe ek hint mention, ek hint hai. Here we have a hint that whichever funding method has been used, different investors have come up together and provided the funding. And who are those investors? The mutual funds, the insurance funds, the institutional investors. So the answer to this question is option D, qualified institutions placement. So let us understand what is this QIP. First of all, I just mentioned that 500 crores this firm is going to raise using the QIPs, okay, where all these mutual fund, insurance fund, banks will come together and provide this funding. So who are institutional investors? This is the very first question which comes up. Institutional investors kaun hote hain? So institutions jo investors ki tarah act kare are the institutional investors. Any company, any organization which invests money on behalf of other people. Now people like you and me invest in mutual fund. We take different insurance policy and invest in insurance firms. We also go for pension plans. So these pension fund companies, insurance companies, mutual fund companies have a lot of money which we investors have given it. So those companies can further invest that money. So what are those companies? They are the institutions that are investing our money. So those institutions are known as institutional investors. Jo hum logo ka paisa further invest kar rahe hain as a institution, as a company, are called institutional investors. They have more financial knowledge, better aware of how to invest vis-a-vis some retail investors like you and me. So they buy, sell stocks, bonds for their customers, for their clients. Mutual fund, pension fund, insurance company, ye sab iske kuch examples hain. They are more sophisticated than investors like us. Okay, that is the reason why they are less regulated vis-a-vis us. Okay, because it is believed that they have more knowledge, they can better protect themselves. So this is the concept of institutional investors. Now talking about qualified institutional placement. Now the company can raise funding by going on for an initial, for an IPO or an FPO, jahan pe aap public ko apne shares issue karte ho, ya fir you issue them for the first time, or aap, ya fir aap further issues karte rehte ho. You have make an equity offer to the general public, they subscribe for it. Okay, then you come up with more shares of your company and raise the funding using the equity. Now, think of a situation where instead of basically issuing that equity to the general public, you are privately placing it with some institutions. Wo paisa aap hum jaise logo ko na offer karke, as a firm, you offer it to some institutional investors like pension fund, mutual fund. Then in that case, it's known as a qualified institutional placement. So what is a QIP? It is the allotment of securities to the qualified institutional buyers. These institutional investors are when given the stocks on a private basis, privately inko shares allot kiye jaate hain company ke and inse funding rates ki jaati hai, that is a QIP. Okay, qualified institutional buyers are nothing but your institutional investors only, who are having a great financial background and they know how to invest the money. So if I talk about the SEBI's list of who are your QIBs, then your mutual funds, your venture capitalists, your insurance companies, your pension fund, provident fund, all these are your QIBs. RBIs, those institutions to whom QIPs can, from whom the funding through QIPs can be raised. So this was all for today's session. We discussed some very important concepts related to RBI master directions, disinvestment, asset monetization, bit cloud, and then finally this qualified institutional placement. So I hope you found this session to be useful. With this, I would like to end up this session. Thank you so much.